All right. So JP gave you a very good summary of what the options are available to you when you use Firebase's rules and security language. But what do these rules actually look like? Before we dive into validation, let's take a quick look at how these rules are structured.
You already saw an example of what rules look like when we looked at the dashboard before. In fact, clicking here is where you'll need to go to edit your rules. Once you're in the Security and Rules tab, you can write your rules here and save them using this button. Any changes that you save will immediately affect any read or write calls sent to your Firebase database. These rules should also look familiar from when in version 0.4 we talked about using index on and value rules. Okay, so here are the default rules. The rules themselves are written in JSON, which looks similar to your Firebase database itself. There are string key value pairs, which are separated by colons. And everything that's considered an object or a list is surrounded by curly braces, as seen here. Remember that these strings are enclosed in quotes. If you're not super familiar with this sort of JSON syntax, I've provided a link to a sample rules file that you could look at to base your rule syntax off of. So what are these rules doing? Well, these are the simplest of simplest rules. Your rules file will always start with this rules object here. And then usually the children inside of it mirror the structure of your actual database. In this case, these rules are providing access to the entire database, no matter what the structure happens to be. It's read and write viewable. And there are no validation rules, so there aren't any structural constraints here. Including these two rules is actually important because by default, access to the data is false. So you do need these rules to explicitly say that read is true for the whole database and write is true for the whole database, because if I actually deleted this and saved it, by default, nobody would be able to write anything to the database. But I'll undo that. Normally, your rules are going to mirror your database structure. So for example, if I wanted to write some rules to validate the structure of my user node, I might write something like this. As you can see here, I've got the exact root node name of the user node. And here, I've got the key names embedded of all the properties. So your key names here need to match exactly what's shown in your database, and they need to be nested in exactly the same way. Now you might be wondering what this key here is all about. The dollar sign followed by a word indicates what is known in Firebase as a wildcard variable. Now, wildcard variables have a couple different uses, but the most common one is to represent dynamic keys, like push IDs, and in this case, user emails. Because remember, under the user node is a list of user emails, the keys of which we can't guess in advance. Now, once you've laid out this structure, you can start defining rules for the user object. When you want to write a rule for a particular location, you go to the location in your rules file that mirrors the location in your database. And this is your first example of a rule. The key of a rule is always a .read, .write, or .validate value. And the value of a rule will always be something that evaluates to a Boolean. And this is important because when a user tries to read or write at that location, the value of this Boolean affects whether they're actually able to do so. Now, these expressions that evaluate to Booleans can get pretty complicated. They can include comparison and logical operators, and Firebase also provides additional methods and internal preset variables that allow you to get a value at the current location or compare to other locations in the database. For example, there are methods that let you look at the data at children and parent locations of your current location. So if necessary, you could do comparisons between the value of name and the value of email, or even the value of name and someplace totally else in the database. Okay, so once you've written this out and you actually start to try to read or write data at certain locations, all of the applicable rules along the path to that location will be checked. Validate and write rules are checked whenever a value is written, and read rules are checked whenever listeners are attached. For example, if I tried to write in this location with the value Lila, any rules that are at the lilafish@gmail.com location, which is this wildcard variable here, there aren't any rules here, and at the name location, which has one validate rule here. So in total, because this is a write, these two rules would be checked. Now let's pretend that this write rule wasn't here. This was actually the rule that was giving me the ability to write to this location. So if you ever tried to do something like that, where you don't have permission to do the action that you want to do, the onCancelled callback method will be triggered in your code, and it'll be given a Firebase error of type permission denied. All right, I've just thrown a lot of information at you. So let me take a moment to summarize. Your rules file is found in the Firebase dashboard in the Security and Rules tab, and the rules themselves are written in JSON. The actual permissions will have keys that are write, read, or validate. And they will always have values that evaluate to either true or false. If there is no read or write rule at a location or its parent locations, then it will default to false. When you're writing a permission rule, you'll place it in the rules location that mirrors the database location that you're interested in. If a user tries to do something that is not allowed by the read, write, or validate rules, a Firebase error will be returned to them, and its value will be permission denied. Okay, and those are basically the facts that you need to get started, so go ahead and we'll start laying out some of these rules.